Hi, I am Professor Tian. I am a macroeconomist.
In this video, we will go over the money supply process. Through our discussion, you will see how intricately connected the banking system is to the creation of money. Let's start with a simple definition of money supply. Economists define money supply as M equals to C plus D, where M is the total supply of money, C is currency in the hands of the public, and D is demand deposits. What are demand deposits? These are deposits in banks that depositors can access on demand simply by writing a check or swiping a debit card, such as those held in checking accounts. Remember that economists define money much more broadly as anything that can be used as payment for goods and services or in repayment of debt. So the mathematical definition of money we have, M equals to C plus D, include both currency as well as demand deposits, because both fit in with that broad definition of money. Since money supply includes demand deposits, the banking system plays an important role in determining the actual money supply M in the economy. Now, in order to figure out how the money supply process works, let's imagine the central bank printed $1,000 worth of currency, and all 1,000 are given out to the public and being held as currency. To simplify things, suppose this is the only money in the economy. We'll consider three different cases here and see what the impact on the money supply is under each scenario, given this initial endowment of $1,000 worth of currency. In case one, when there are no banks at all, and the central bank has printed $1,000 that's circulating as currency, we have currency equal to 1,000. No deposits since there are no banks. So total money supply is exactly the same as the initial amount of money the central bank printed, 1,000. In case two, we now have banks. Assume that households utilize the banks and deposit all $1,000 into a bank. But these banks are a little unusual. They act more like safe deposit boxes, since we assume they just take in deposits and hold on to all of them without doing any lending. We call this 100% reserve banking system because banks hold all deposits on reserve in their vaults. Now, nothing is being held as currency, so C is equal to zero, while deposits equal to 1,000. So the total money supply is still equal to 1,000, exactly the same as the initial amount of money the central bank printed. So far, pretty boring. With or without banks, the total money supply is equal to what the central bank printed initially. In case three, though, things start to get interesting. Banks exist in our economy to help match those who save with those who want to borrow. Banks profit in the process from the difference in the interest borrowers pay them and the interest they pay the depositors. So normal banks do not hold onto all deposits as reserves. In fact, they only hold a small fraction of deposits as reserves and lend out the rest. Therefore, the banking system we have in reality is a fractional reserve banking system. Let us suppose that just like in case two, households deposit all $1,000 worth of initial currency endowment into the banking system, and that banks hold on to just 10% of their total deposits as reserves. The other 90% they lend out. What is currency holding now? C is equal to zero because households have deposited everything into the banks initially, and the initial deposit is equal to 1,000, same as in case two. However, because the banks now lend out 90% of this 1,000 as deposits, so a lucky borrower will be able to receive $900 worth of loans if the borrower keeps the loans as cash on hand first. How much additional currency do you think we have? We should have $900 additional currency now, 0.9 times 1,000. So deposits remain the same at 1,000 since no one withdrew any money. Our total money supply is now M equals to C plus D, $1,900. Therefore, in a fractional reserve banking system, just like magic, the banks have created money. The money supply creation process does not have to stop with a single borrower. If this borrower decides to deposit their $900 loan proceeds into a bank as well instead of holding it as cash. And that bank also keeps just 10% of the new deposit as reserves and lend the rest out, we will end up with additional increases in deposits and currency. So an additional deposit of 900 give us 1,900 in total deposits. How about total currency holding? The first borrower has no more currency since they deposited into a bank, but the second borrower has 0.9 multiplied by $900 of deposits equals to 810 in new loans, which if they choose to hold as currency, will give us currency equal to 810. Adding currency and deposits together give us a grand total of 2,710 in money supply. So by depositing its borrowings back into the banking system, the first borrower has helped to create more money. This process of money creation can keep going till infinity and beyond. In fact, we can calculate how much money in total would be created if the process continues indefinitely. Assuming that all banks keep just 10% of total deposits on reserve and lend out the rest, and assuming that no borrowers keep any cash, so every dollar given out as a loan comes back into the banking system as deposits, we can make use of an infinite geometric series formula to calculate total deposits. D is equal to 1 divided by 0.1 times 1,000. 0.1 is the 10% banks keep on reserve. 1,000 is that initial money that the Fed has created. This gives us a total deposit amount of 10,000. Currency holding is equal to 0 since no one is holding onto any cash. And total money supply in this economy, M equals to C plus D, would be equal to $10,000. Comparing that to what we started off with, money has grown 10 times by churning through the banking system. The factor of 10 that we multiply the initial $1,000 created by the central bank is referred to as money multiplier, since it tells us how many multiples the money supply will grow from that initial endowment of money. It is important for us to remember that money creation can only happen in the banking system if banks choose to develop loans. The more reserves they hold, the less there is for loans. Less loans, less money creation, because there is less opportunity for those loans to come back into the banks as deposits. Hence, the money multiplier is affected by the reserve holding behavior of banks. And the more reserves banks choose to hold, the smaller the multiplier will be. Similarly, if borrowers or households choose to hold on to some cash instead of depositing everything into the banking system, there will be less money creation. More currency holding means less deposits, and less deposits means banks have less to give out as loans, and hence less potential future deposits. Remember that money only gets created through the banking system. So if we hold on to more cash, less gets into the banking system, which will reduce the amount of money that can be created. I would also like to emphasize that even though a fractional reserve banking system creates money, it does not create wealth. Bank loans give borrowers new money, but also an equal amount of debt. Money is a nominal variable after all, and more of it does not mean there is increased real production in the economy.
I hope you have a good idea now how money creation takes place after watching this short video. We covered the definition of money supply and walked through how money multiplies in a fractional reserve banking system. Working through a numerical example on your own is the best way to get comfortable with this challenging topic. So please explore additional resources on this topic available to you on Chegg.